let's do it fast.
Okay, recording is rolling. Okay, guys, now the slides and the PDF file can be found over here. This tiny URL is actually open to all for modern world history for elective history students. All the notes and everything are actually found on this link. I think some of the teachers have already told me that, but you can take a look at it. If not, then you can look at the PowerPoint slides that given to you. Later, once I get the video itself, I will upload the video to the website. Okay, so what are we going to do today? Today, I just wanted you to understand a little bit. Okay, at this point of time, you are really coming to the end of the journey to prepare for your whole life lesson. So when it comes to our history lecture, I just want you to understand certain big ideas first before we even talk about how to go about answering questions. Now, the first big idea that we're going to talk about is, I'm going to explain to you how solving questions go in the context of history, which is a little bit different from social study. And then I'm going to just give you a little bit of comment on SEQs. Very, very brief thing, because SEQ is not my priority. A lot of information that you learn how to go about writing an essay depends on the kind of content that you have. So I'm not going to spend too much time on SEQ. The crux of the whole entire discussion is going to be on the SEQ itself. Now, to start off with all this thing, I want you to understand this very important slide. This is the most important slide that you need to understand for today's session. This is the most important slide. Why is that so? First of all, every subject that you're taking in the O-level examination has certain expectations. I think all of you already know. Ms. Kong go after you for certain accuracy in terms of decimal places, in terms of the choice of words that you use. Okay? Mathematics emphasize certain, for example, number of significant figures, decimal points, and so on and so forth. Do you know why is it that different discipline requires different things? Because every discipline has certain core value and core thinking skill that we want to calculate. For example, why do we do math? What is the marks that is awarded for math? Math is awarded for two things. One, your working and your accuracy, right? If your answer is correct, you get marked for that. So far, so good. You understand? It requires you to understand certain mathematical concepts. And if you are able to display that in your working, you get the marks. Same thing, logical thinking in terms of science, whether is it chemistry, whether is it physics, it requires you to do calculation. It requires you to understand and to explain in certain terms. How do you talk about force, momentum, how do you talk about reaction, how do you talk about this idea of concept of precipitate, and so on and so forth. So accuracy of language, all these things plays a part. Same thing if you're a geography student or whether you are a history student. All our discipline have something very important in us, and this is what we call our concept. Okay, now why is the concept very, very important? The concept is very important because in history, we are looking at these concepts. Okay, so can you pay attention over here? First thing first, in history, in concept, we look at this idea called context. In SBQ, we emphasize a lot on context. Okay, I will talk about it in a while. Context refers to when you learn about the source. When you learn about the source, you want to know, when you have a source-based case study, you want to know what exactly happened. You are expected to know what exactly happened. And the examiner expects you to show them what exactly has happened. This is different from your social study. Because in your social study, the expectation is not there. Every time when you get a SS practice paper, if you look at all your practice papers, they are all talking about different topics. Correct? They are all talking about different topics. Some of the topics you may have seen it for the first time in your life. Correct? Whether is it about disability, whether it's about whether the elderly can use ICT and so on and so forth. All these are the first time they see their life. I don't expect you to know what's going on. But in history, this is not the case. In history, the expectation is that you must know what the case study is. So you are expected to use what you understood from the case study to help you to frame your answer. You understand what I'm trying to tell you so far? Now, this is one context which we are talking about. So the historical context is very important, which is why you notice that in your answer, there is this expectation that I need to use contextual knowledge. You realize that, but SF don't require you to do that. You follow me so far. So to do well for the paper, contextual knowledge needs to come in. Later I'll tell you how to go about it. Now, history is about certain key ideas. When you learn about factors, when you talk about reason, you understand this idea of what we call causation. Something happened is because of reasons that's happening in the past. And because of the event, there will always be likely impact. So how does it comes into the context of source-based case study? Because in source-based case study, when sources are given to you, usually it is actually a reaction of people towards a certain event. Or it's because of certain action that was taken by certain people that resulted to certain event. You understand me so far? So in history, this causation will play a part in sometime in your answering of source-based study. Later we'll see some example. Next thing, there is this idea of change and continuity. When you're in lower secondary, we talk about similarities and differences. This is actually trying to get you to think about what has changed, what has remained the same. What has changed, what has remained the same. And when you are in upper sec, you learn this and, oh, this is about similarity and differences. But in actual fact, this is about how things have changed from one thing to another. And this relationship is usually linked to this idea of historical significance. Because when an event, a cause, a factor, or personality reacts in a certain manner, there is certain change, there is certain continuity. In the examination, it is not just about telling the examiner, I see this and this, there's a change. But rather, can you account for why this change takes place? Or can you account why this thing remains the same? You understand me so far? And then it goes back to the first C again, which is context. You will never be able to understand why this person suddenly reacts in a different manner over a space of time if you do not know exactly what has happened in between the period of time you're talking about. Which is why it goes back to the big C, which is context. Now, I know I'm not trying to confuse you, but I want you to start thinking about it. Because in history, you can still use your social study method and talk about how to evaluate answers. There's nothing wrong with it. You will still do okay. But in history, the edge that you will get is that you need to put everything in the historical context that's happening at that point in time. Okay? So with that, let me move on to this. Okay? In history, the expectation of you, just like in math, just like in science, there's expectation of you. You need to understand what is the context behind the song. Okay? You cannot answer a question just by looking at the source. Do you understand me so far? It's not like SS. SS, you can just look at the source and answer the question. It's the same thing. What's the message of the source in an SS question is going to be very different with what's the message of the cartoon in a history question. Because there is always an historical knowledge that you need to use to support. And that is an expectation on you as a historian. You follow me so far? Later, I'm going to explain another example to illustrate all this thing. Second thing, your answer that you have should not be just based on, I repeat that, your answers that you have should not be just based on the contextual knowledge. You still have to use the source and then talking about the source, then you bring in that big idea, okay, this is how the historical context.
Sorry.
Can you settle down very quickly? Find a place and sit down. Okay, don't disrupt the recording. They just find a place to sit down. There are some places over here that you can stretch yourself out. There are some places over here that you can please come and sit down. Okay. go back for the benefit of all of you, okay, the slides are found over here. I'm going to move back again. Okay, the slides are over here. I'm going to give you about 1 minute. Didn't actually pause it for a while. Okay, I'm going to give you 1 minute to scan this, then after that, I'm going to start. First of all, okay, when we talk about analyzing of sources, whatever skills that you use, whether is it reliability, whether is it message, inference, or whatever, all the skills that you have, there must be that awareness of that historical knowledge that we're talking about. Okay, there must be awareness that there's a historical knowledge that we're talking about. Okay, the next thing. The next thing is about provenance. Okay, the next thing is about provenance. Other than using the historical context, the next thing that is very, very important, the next thing that is very, very important is this analysis of the provenance linking to the context. This is something that you are already very familiar with when we talk about reliability. But however, in history, the provenance plays a very, very important role in allowing you to understand the source and the previous. First of all, when we talk about provenance, as a historian, recall time is always our main currency. Geographers, your currency is actually talking about space. That is your currency. That is your main discipline. For history, our main discipline, our main context is this idea about time. And therefore, when we look at time and we talk about this idea of multiple perspectives, our interest is on the provenance. Who is this person? When did they make this song? Why did he say this? And what was the date? So, in history especially, a lot of the time, dates are given in sources. Dates are always given in sources. And if the source is date, that means that you should assume that the date is significant and it must be incorporated in your answer. So if I tell you, this is a Hitler poster, this is a Nazi poster, printed in 1933, you need to tell me what was exactly happening in 1933. So, source-based question is not easy. A lot of you, in SS, yes, it is very easy, because all you need to do is to apply the skill. But in history, it is the direct opposite, because the expectation of you is that you know exactly what is going on at that particular period of time. Understand? Your teachers have really been telling you what are the likely topics that will appear for all of you. If I'm not mistaken, the key topics that we're talking about is in book. Okay? Hitler and Stalin is one of them. Of course, the other one is your CMC and Korean War. But what was the topic that is likely to appear for all of you? For pure history, it's a different thing. Don't get yourself confused. I'm talking about your elective students. Elective students, that means 4-5, 4-4. What is the topic that is likely to appear for you? Don't get confused. What is the topic that is likely to appear for you? Salim and CMC came out for last year the topic that came out for elective history. Pure history, don't get confused. Elective history, the last year topic that came up was on Germany. Correct? It was on Germany. So that means that this year, likelihood Germany should not appear. But there always has been a trend, it always repeats. The topic that is likely to appear for all of you is your Korean War. That's why you have been doing Korean War. And the other topic is Stalin. This is for the elective history. Please don't get confused. Elective history. Your history, your topics are on two different books, so they are not the same, so don't confuse yourself. Okay, now, the next thing I want you to pay attention is, because our discipline also focuses on this idea that we're talking about different people responding in different manners. We are very interested in knowing multiple perspectives. We know that different people will say different things. Under different circumstances, we'll say different things. Our belief is that every one of them has certain value in the things that they say. Therefore, we want to be interested in knowing about when do you say it, in what context that you're talking about. What is the provenance? So things like this. Okay, one example. the concept of autobiography. What is an autobiography? It's an autobiography dependable. An autobiography is somebody who wrote about his own life. Of course, you can ask yourself, first of all, is an autobiography reliable, or is he trying to justify certain things that already happened? Why do you write something about yourself after an event is over? There are two ways of looking at it, right? One way is to what?
Honest reflection.
It's an honest reflection, because this has happened, this is how I see it. That there is also a situation that it could be a justification of policy and action. So you need to ask yourself, which one is it? Okay, which one is it? For what reason? At what time? When you write it, at what time, also can affect the reliability of the song. For example, now we talk about David Cameron. David Cameron is a man who had initiated Brexit. He was the one, you also know Brexit, because I tested all of you during your prelim examination. Remember about the UK immigration and people Britain wanted to leave Europe, EU, the European Union. The person who initiated that, David Cameron, was the one that you see in one of the sources. When he say that I've done a lot of things and so on and so forth, but at the end of it, the UK citizen actually initiated Brexit. Okay, that means they all want to leave Britain, EU. Now the question is, he had just written, why is Brexit? Brexit is Britain exit. Britain exit. B-R-E-X-I-T. Go and look at your SS prelim examination papers. Okay? Now, the person, the Prime Minister at that point of time is David Cameron. And you see him, he was in one of the songs. If he were to write an autobiography now, is it to do a reflection, or is it to justify that it's actually not his fault that all these things have turned out that way? Do you know that he's actually going on a world tour, say an apology tour? He's going around to talk to people, he's going to position it like an apology tour. Like, you know, those are rock band who goes up and have all the, he's going to position it. So, you could see there's a lot of remorse in him. So, obviously, this autobiography is to do what? Some form of justification that actually is not my fault. You understand where I'm coming from? So it depends on what is the context of it. Second thing, look at this thing about an author perspective. If an event has happened, and somebody reacted to it, you need to ask yourself, when was the information written? When did he write the song? If the source is written during the event, what's the problem when somebody is doing, saying something to you when the event is happening? You think about it. If something is happening, first of all, if there's an accident that happened and immediately I ask you, the accident that just happened, I come to you and ask you, whatever that you say is only going to be whatever that you see or saw in that sense, correct? And depending on it. So you will not see the whole picture. Can you see the difference? So that means that your perspective is only this. But however, comparatively, it is after the event is over. What happened? Now everything is over, you don't have to fight a fire, right? For example, the Korean War, you don't have to fight a fire. 2 years after the whole incident that happened, I look, when I made this decision, there were other things that was happening. Does that make my answer more reliable? See that? You understand where I'm coming from? So time plays a very big issue. 2 years after, ask yourself, 20 years later. 20 years later, I'm looking at the same event as and I'm talking about the same event. Is there a need 20 years later to still prove to myself that I didn't do anything wrong 20 years later? No need really, because all the people are all gone or whatever. If let's say Robert Kennedy is still around, and you ask him about the Cuban Missile Crisis, ask him now. He's no longer a political leader, he's going to be very truthful in whatever that he says. If you understand my content, it depends on the time and the situation. Okay, now, the last one that we always have been asking you to do. Okay, the things that we always asking you all to do. First thing, whenever you check on reliability, we talk about cross-referencing. And in history, the good thing is that when you cross-refer, you can actually use historical knowledge. Because it is what was happening at that when you know, because you know the context, you can use historical knowledge to try to make sense of what's going on. And you notice that in SS, we usually don't encourage you to use so. Okay, in SS, we usually don't encourage you to use so. For obvious reasons, because you don't know what is going on in terms of the source. You don't know about that, you don't know about the content. Now, one more thing to remind all of you. When we talk about prominent, you need to understand that everything changes. You need to be aware that because of the time and when the source is being written, there will always be some form of changes in our sense. And that will mean this idea of, okay, the source itself may not be reliable, and the reason why it's not reliable is because of what will happen. The things have changed over a period of time. Does it make sense to you so far? So in history, these are the four types of concepts that you need to be very mindful of. The concept of context, the concept of time. This is something that we as a historian we always focus on. And the last one is the concept of perspective. When two groups of people are saying different things, in the SS method, it's very straightforward. One is reliable, one is not reliable. Correct? That's the usual thing. This one is reliable, this one is not reliable. Cross referencing, check prominence, and tone, and so on and so forth. It will still work in SS, but the higher level understanding is why is it that the two of them are saying different things? Rather than, I think you're right, I think you're wrong. In SS, it's very straightforward. But in history, it why is it that he's saying it in this way and why you are saying it in this way? You are both looking at things, same event, from different perspectives. Can you tell me what the perspective is? Okay? Now, so the next question comes. Okay, so Mr. has talked about all these things. Let's start off with the first thing on historical knowledge. What do you mean by historical knowledge? Now, every time when you use historical knowledge, what I mean is that it can be used about the content, it can also be used in the problem. What do I mean by this? Number one, you use it to increase the knowledge of the content. Every time when you're given a source, you make an inference, you make a guess, then after that you tell the examiner, okay, I know something more and I want to tell you. That is usually the way that all of you do. Correct? For example, you know about Hitler rise to power. There's a source that talks about Hitler rise to power. And then you want to tell the examiner, okay, from my contextual knowledge, I know that there was an event called the Enabling Act, or the Reich Tech Fire, that allowed him to take over total control. Correct? So you will add in your contextual knowledge in that manner. This is what we call using historical knowledge to increase the understanding of the context. That has always been the way that you're always doing it. There's nothing wrong with that. That should be the way. And when I talk about contextual knowledge, it must be specific. You cannot tell me, okay, the source says this, from what I learned in my textbook, this is true. From what I learned in my textbook, and then you paraphrase the whole entire thing again. That is not specific information. If you talk about Hitler's rise to power in the source, you need to focus on this idea of what were some of the key events that we're talking about. Clear so far? So this is one thing about historical knowledge, using it to increase understanding of the context. Now, the second thing is to make sense of what was happening at that point of time. That means your historical knowledge is used to understand what was the context. So for example, in the source, it's written that it was a source that is published in 1934. And it is a picture of Hitler, you know, the poster of Hitler in 1934. Then your historical knowledge is to tell me what is happening at that point of time. Why is the cartoon presented, or why is the poster presented this way? Therefore, the historical knowledge that we're talking about is at that point of time, Hitler was creating this idea of control over the media. Everything is under his own control, he's controlling propaganda. So because of this, you see posters like this. You understand the difference already or not? One of them is using the whatever content, you use your contextual knowledge to strengthen the content. The other thing is, I give you a provenance, and now you are using your contextual knowledge to explain why that provenance is in that letter. Make sense? So, for example, you have a source about Stalin, and you saw a poster about Stalin, who asked people, oh, let's continue to work for our country. Now, after explaining and talking about this, of course, you can use the contextual knowledge and say that, oh, this implies a fire ban. Or Stalin wanted people to work for the fire ban. Or you can go into that will be method number one. The poster is in relation to the fire ban. From what I understand from the fire ban, Hitler Stalin wanted to increase production, industrial output, and so on and so forth. So that is using your contextual knowledge to your historical knowledge to add on to the content. That's one way. Or you can use the second way and say that at that point of time, I know that Stalin country is a country that is trying to create his cult of personality. He uses propaganda to make sure that he gets his idea across. So that's why you have something like this, which is a poster. You understand where I'm coming from so far? So there are two ways that you can use historical knowledge. It is not just add on to the content. It can also add on to your understanding of what exactly is happening. Does it make sense to you so far? So this is something that you seldom do. So whenever you're given a source, you need to use your historical knowledge to try to add on to what's going on. Okay, that being in mind, okay, let's look at these two sources. Okay, these two sources are Stalin. Okay, now the question is very straight cut. These two sources, one is on you all have the information, those of you who do not, you can take a look at this. Now, source B and source C are both opinions about Stalin. Okay, let's look at, so source C makes you surprised by what source B said. For those of you who attended my lecture previously, which one is the content, which one is the target? Which one is the content, which one is the target? C is the content, B is the target. So which one are we actually more interested in if it is a social study question?
C.
You are more interested in C. But in the examination, let's say, Mr. If I work on C, am I wrong? You're not wrong. You're still correct. But in history, there's a little bit more expectation on you. You don't just look at C. You look at both C and B, and you ask yourself, why is it that C and B are writing it in that manner? Do you follow me so far? In history, that is that expectation for you. You are expected to do a little bit more. Okay, for those of you who are geography students, who are doing elective geography, they say, oh, well, geography, you need to study a lot. History skill set is the same. Yes, they are the same, but there are more expectations for a history elective student or history student. Okay, so clear, I'm just going to look at this. Now, this one is written by a historian in 1983. So, what kind of impression does it really give you? Even without reading the source, what do you expect from him? Because of his prominence, you expect him as a historian. What's the expectation of a historian? Somebody who is very fair. Very fair, very balanced in terms of the viewpoint. Somebody who has done research. So your understanding of a historian is that he's somebody who has done research, who knows what is going on. And the best part about it was that it was written in 1983. That means Stalin has already passed on. His position of he himself will not influence how the source will go. Does it make sense to you? You will not influence how the, because Stalin is not going to be there to, remember the context, he will not be there to pressure you to say good things about him. It's not going to happen. So he is going to be giving you a very, very unbiased viewpoint about how you feel about it. So he says that people did not think that Stalin would have rise to power. But let's look at this source maybe then. Source B is by this man who was in prison with Stalin in 1908. You all know why Stalin was in prison, right? Because he was a communist, and then he was arrested because he's still part of the, at that point of time, he was still part of the Tsar, which is the Russian emperor. So because he was locked up, he was a so-called a radical and extremist. Therefore, he was locked up. And this man, who was in the same prison as him, say this thing about Stalin. And now there's a very, very interesting thing. It was published in a magazine in 1928. What's your expectation already? 1928, what's the context? Already starting on the five-year ban, Stalin has already come to. Very good. So what do you think is the control over the media? There will be strict control over the media, which means all this information that go through to the people in Russia must be something that is acceptable by the government. So even without looking at the source, you probably already know he's going to say something positive because of where it comes from. Now you compare this. So I ask you, does C make you surprised? Easy way. First part in your FF, content differences, content similarity. Surprise means they say different thing. Similar means they say same thing. Correct? Surprise, not surprise. That's what we do in SF. Now the highest level is at the end of it. Why is it that surprising? Because for him, he has the opportunity to look at multiple viewpoints. As a historian, the expectation is that based on who he is, perspective, he will look at multiple ideas and then he will present what he sees. For him, he doesn't have the benefit of it because at that point of time, the context was that Stalin is controlling the media because of this cult of personality. So everything that goes to the people has to be positive about him. So therefore, these two are definitely going to say different things. So, you expected this to happen, therefore, are you surprised? Okay, so let's move on to the result. So this was in 2010, O-level paper. The expectation that you need to understand that the year plays a difference. That's what our discipline is all about. You understand? Because it was written in 1928, what was happening at that point? In 1980, what was happening at that point? Okay, some of you will also be asking, Mr. The 1980 part, can I look at it as the Cold War was also coming to an end? So they can be a little bit more vocal at it. The answer is yes. So even though we're still talking about Stalin, and this source is now written in 1980, you can still say that there is some, you understand what was the historical content, and that means that the Cold War was actually coming to an end. 1980 to very coming to an end. So there is no more pressure to write nasty things about one another anymore. Imagine if this source was written in 1960, the historian, there might be a historical context at the time. Are we clear about this so far? Okay? Yes. Yeah, you have to look at both the CAP contextual knowledge to evaluate both the provenance of B and C. You understand? So B and C both have to be revisited. Yeah.
So if we weigh both of the provenance, then how do we conclude?
It's not about weighing both of the provenance. It is about understanding why both of them. Read carefully, listen carefully. It is about understanding why the two of them say things in that manner. Do you follow me so far? That means you are aware why they are saying different things. So I'm not surprised by it. The straightforward way is because one is reliable, one is not reliable. You argue that, because one is reliable, one is not reliable. But at the end of it, it's not just about this. It's about making sense that I know that these two sources are saying different things. They are saying different things, but I'm aware why they are saying different things. Do you follow me so far? It's not about, I think this is right, this is wrong. So I'm not surprised. Actually, the highest level will always be, I will not be surprised. Because I'm aware why these two things happen. You get what I'm trying to tell you? Because as a historian, you need to know what exactly is happening. Okay? Now, let's move on to this one. This one is a more interesting song. This is relating to the Korean War, something that's likely to appear for all of you. Now, in 1950, President Truman speaks at a press conference, saying we're not at war. Okay? Republic of Korea were attacked by North Korea. Okay? The United Nations held a meeting, and then after that, they say that UN is going to help Korea. We are going to chase off the bandit raid. That means North Korea is a bandit. They are trying to take over Korea. And that is all that is to it. Now, look at soft E now. Soft E says that I did this for the United Nations. That means I did the Korean War for the United Nations. The League of Nations, I believe the League of Nations, it failed. A lot of people thought that we failed because we're not there to support it. Okay, now we started, it was our idea, it's a big test, therefore we just cannot let it come. So now the question is, how far does this song tell me that he's actually telling me? They are both made by the same person, but they seem to suggest very different things. Correct? One suggests that I'm doing it because I'm trying to chase on a bandit. The other one said, I do it because I have no choice. I need to support the UN. Can you see that difference, Jaden? Is it made by the same person?
Yes.
Then the old argument in SS is that, oh, that means that this is false. This is true. It's a rhetorical question. In SS, it's very straight cut, right? Oh, that means one is false, one is true. But you ask yourself this logic. It's the same person, no? How can he be telling the truth and telling a lie at the same time? Correct? So there must be something that has changed. Why have changed? And can you take a look at the provenance? They seem to be saying different things. The key idea here is USA is going in to stop this bandit, to stop North Korea. Here they say that I actually didn't want it one, but because I started the UN, so I need to support it. So I did this because I want to support the UN. This one shows that they need to do something about it. This one says that actually I've been ushered in, I've been forced by the UN in that sense to support UN, that's what I'm doing. So they are taking his in this sort, he's taking away his responsibility. Now you ask yourself this question. This was written in 1956. After he had stepped down as the president, he wrote a memoir. Memoir is like an autobiography. So, is this reliable or not reliable? At this point of time, some of you are saying yes, but because he's reflecting on his own thing. But, like I told you, an autobiography can work the other way around. Because I can write things to tell the world that I'm actually not at home. Can I do that? I can, right? I can do that. Okay, so can you understand the context here? Let you have some time to read up the song. So, you must ask yourself this. The role of the U.S. in the first place is that, are they protecting or are they trying to gain territory? That means they are fighting against North Korea because they are trying to get rid of North Korea. Or they are just there because I need to do some form of protection. It seems to suggest, in the second one, it seems to suggest that he is trying to protect. Then the next question is, this two, right? Which one sounds more, why is it that he says different things? We do not know whether exactly, is he lying? In which one? But the reason why he say different thing is because his focus is he was looking at two different groups. He was talking in a memoir. That's how I feel about this thing. I want the world to know this is what actually I think, what actually happened. Whether he tried to manipulate, we do not know. But that is how he did. But at that point of time when he was at the press conference, do you think he can go out and say that? This is a war, this is a Cold War turn hot. This is a Cold War turn hot. Meaning, this is no longer a civil war, it is a proxy war now. Can he go out and say that in 1950? You will never say that, right? Because once you say that, what is going to happen? Now you all have the historical context, right? Immediately you say that, what is going to happen? Soft, not The Russians are going to say, oh, so you want to make this into a war? Fine. You want to start it? Let's go. But what did Truman has always been doing in 1950? This is a situation that's happening. What am I doing? I'm trying to help. I'm trying to help South Korea. Poor thing, poor country that being bullied by another country. Okay, I'm coming in to help them because they should not interfere with one another.